broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Johnson. TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin!
Welcome to the finale of Legends. So sad. Well, finale two. It was really two episodes cut together. Well, not even cut together.
Not
just
even.
Two episodes.
Just two episodes. But I'm bursting after watching
that. So much stuff going on.
I know. I think you probably wanted to kill me because, like, we were watching. I just kept all the time. I was like, oh, what about this? What about this?
No, it was great. Like,
it was
amazing. And what I'm more mad about was my prediction from the first episode. I was exactly spot on about. And then it was like, I didn't get to be right. Really?
What
I
was only, your original prediction?
I was only right. Well, the whole, like, MI6 thing.
You definitely called that.
But, like, I didn't get to brag about it, really, even though I'm trying to brag right now about it.
Well, I nailed the Sonya thing.
Yeah, you did.
She's a legend.
You totally did.
But we didn't know till the very end, so well done,
But
writers.
You also got to say that in a previous after show before they revealed
it. Again.
So, Carrie Long is joining us.
Hey,
also
guys.
Doubling as JB tonight. Also Carrie Long.
We look identical, so,
I mean, pretty
you
much,
know.
You know.
Huh.
It's weird. You've also got the poofed up hair.
Just like him.
Just like him.
He wanted to be Maggie.
He did.
Yeah,
Jamie, we're just going to talk shit about you the whole episode for not being here. Hey, guys, I'm Dave Klein, just ready to talk all that crap about JV. But last week, the song that we played was from the movie Black Death.
Mm-hmm.
And now, since this is the finale, we're actually playing a song from the finale, which is called Devil on My Back by Stony, I believe.
Yeah, great song.
Yeah, really good song.
I got all excited when
it
came
on. It's a cool
on.
Song. I'll download it. I'm gonna use some free advertising to Stony, so.
You're welcome. I was trying to see.
You're welcome.
That is who it is. Yep, confirmed.
So let's go ahead and start about the talk about the first episode where we're still on the whole storyline with Bashir and Hassan,
mm-hmm.
and Martin right in the middle of it. Martin being tortured as the microchip is being removed, getting repeatedly punched in the face. But a nice badass moment from him.
It was. He was Mr. Tough Guy.
I want you to know something,
well,
Carrie.
Yes.
I'm gonna kill you.
Oh, I know. I tweeted that out, guys. If you follow me, you would know that. What a great line. He's such a badass. There's something you need to know. I'm going to kill you.
Yeah.
How many times in a week, a month, a year, can you actually say that and mean it? You can't, because you have to be Sean Bean.
Or a serial killer.
Or a serial killer.
And then you actually
confirmed.
Could mean
it.
It
was pretty awesome.
Yeah. That also works.
Oh, there
you
go. Say,
yeah. And you could live in Britain and be copying Dexter. And, you know. Current events. So, Crystal wants to know from Nelson how they knew Martin was undercover. And this is going to be a concurrent theme throughout mm-hmm. both episodes is how did they know Martin was undercover? So that is a huge issue with all that. And during that moment, as she's kind of bombarding Nelson, we get Fox Echo Zulu 911 from... Sonya,
yeah,
heading to Nelson. So now we get it confirmed that she did, in fact, get that text out.
She did, right, because we were concerned about that. It's nice to know.
Right.
So the phone. The phone came back into play, too, because I know we'll get to it.
Just
we're talking about a phone. Aiden was a super smart, savvy kid. Clearly the genetic spawn of two legends, because he's like, Mom, I picked up the phone. And she didn't even notice.
Yeah, Aiden is a little badass.
Yeah.
I mean, also,
he's
I mean, this
so
is the
chill,
scene too. Yeah, like as he's being interrogated by terrorists, and like they have him wrapped up. He's like, "Yeah, you better lay your hands off my mom."
Yeah,
total
what
badass.
What do you do about it, Aiden? Nothing but my mom. Meanwhile, and he was so calm. What? Like normally a 9 will just be losing it, just freaking out. This kid's all like, "I got this."
Yeah.
I got this. Yeah.
A little badass Aiden, and then that's when they call up Martin on the phone and have a back and forth as Martin gets to see Sonya kicking ass. So just another notch there of like, told me it's a car accident, you told me we're married, and now you're kicking
lies.
Ass.
Lies. All of it lies. But I like, because as soon as she kicks some ass, I was like, hold the phone. Like, he's going to notice this. And then, well done, writers. Later on the show, you were all like explaining it.
Yeah.
I was irritated at first. I was like, what? Come on. But hey, they let us hang on for it for just a bit, and then it got explained.
Yeah.
Justified, I think, would be a better term there.
That's the wrong show, actually. We're talking about Legends right now,
right,
so I'm
not
sorry.
Justified.
Sorry, wrong show.
Timothy Olyphant.
But Martin breaks and snaps at this point with his whole family, and not sure. Or Bashir.
Bashir, yeah.
Bashir,
he's
not
like
exactly the smartest terrorist
no,
in the
come
world.
Come on. Has he never watched any other, like, terrorist drama scene from any other
TV
show?
Like, it's funny because, like, everything up to this point was, like, so smart.
Yes.
They were doing.
I wrote that. I wrote fight scene, and then there's a very unhappy face here. And
yeah.
I wrote, come on. Because they were so attention to detail to get him in the semi and be all high tech. And
yeah.
then you set this killer free, and he kicks your ass. Like, come on.
Yeah, I just wrote stupid.
Like, stupid, yeah.
But I mean, it's more like the scene itself. I was like, I mean, they need to get him out. Yeah, it's just a weak scene, honestly.
Yeah. There, you guys are better than that. Come on.
I mean, there's great writing throughout both
Fantastic.
Episodes. But this one scene was just like, I guess that's why it stands out.
Yeah, maybe it was
like,
late at night and they all wanted to go home.
There's just like, yeah, it's like, guys, it's 3 a.m. I've been eating, we've already ordered 4 pizzas and we have 2 boxes of donuts. I just
want
to go home.
We're already in OT. Let's get out of here. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, I mean, they're not paying for OT. We're on salary.
It's true.
It's even worse. I'd stick around for OT.
I would.
We're on double OT at this point.
What a run. Let that clock run.
Yeah, so kind of a poorly written scene, but whatever. Martin's
but just one
badass.
Scene, right?
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Everything else was spot on.
No, everything.
Everything.
So Crystal and Rice head over to Martin's house, but they are too late at this point.
Too late.
What you gonna do? What you gonna do? Too late. But it does add that another element to it that, hey, at least Hassan's not an idiot. You know, maybe Bashir got the idiot poll. He lost biggest idiot in the terrorist team. But Hassan, he's good. He's smart.
He's spot on. He knew to go to an old narcotics area.
Right. But that's the place to head to. You're like, oh, we know where old narcotics used to hang. Yeah, of course.
Now we know why Agent Rice is here.
Yeah.
For that one moment. Oh, yeah, I remember that area. We used to do narcotic ops over there. I know the house.
Good thing, like, a convenient,
house.
Like, I feel like a lot of times Agent Rice's character is the most convenient character. Like, oh, yeah, my dad actually ran an auto dealership. I don't know if you knew that. So,
nice.
Like, anything, like, just pull Agent Rice for some way that he's going to be the able to one who can call out something.
Truth. Very true.
Yeah. So, Martin calls Nelson and finds out where Sonia and Aiden are missing. But, yeah, so Martin's such a badass that he, while they're like, we're freaking out, and Martin just calls them as Maggie's like, we have Martin on the phone.
On the phone.
Yeah.
Just if anyone cares. Just so you know. Yeah.
But I like Maggie's acting in that scene.
Maggie's great. And
yeah.
This is why I know we're going to talk about season 2, you know. And just for the record, everything we have scrolled through online, we cannot find confirmation of either a season renewal or cancellation.
Yeah.
So, and I think they're just going to wait for the ratings from, you know, tonight, obviously.
It might even be something that's just on the block until next year.
Could
be. Find out about, so.
Could be, and you never know. You know, maybe it gets snatched up and is online somewhere or something.
I am kind of hungry tonight now that you mention it.
You are, yeah.
Yeah,
sorry.
Now that there's
snatched.
No popcorn and.
Yeah. What are we going to do? No popcorn for a season finale, but that's all right. The season was
full. Yeah, we wanted to chow down on some popcorn.
We did.
For season finale, but there's none. There's none. Steven in the booth. What's with that? So Martin comes into the office in person, and he wants to interrogate Bashir. He also drags in Bashir.
Mm-hmm.
So he drags him in, which is great, and just wants to interrogate him himself. And Sonya's going to be there to reel him in,
mm-hmm.
which he doesn't want at
Crystal.
All.
Crystal.
Crystal. Sonya's having a conflict with Hassan. That was what I was writing. But yeah, so we have that like mini conflict with Hassan and Sonya where it's just like Sonya wants Aiden to eat.
Yeah, and that was, because she was, and then I liked that, what was his line? He was like, oh, a woman, not much of a cook, but, you know, breaking ribs or something.
Right. Well, he says something about like, you have secrets too. I think.
Yeah.
But yeah.
It was nice. And I kind of curious why Aiden wasn't like, what do you mean, Mom? Like, if he's that smart, or maybe he knows. Who
maybe
knows?
He just figured
maybe
it.
The kid is a legend.
I mean,
youngest
I think
legend
kids
in
are
the department.
Smarter than, yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
I think a lot of
smart.
Kids are smarter than people give them credit to. And
true, true.
He probably just kind of figured it out. Like, my mom's more, yeah, I think he figured it out.
My mom's a badass.
At least I like to think he did. In my head, he figured it out. That's my headcanon right there. So, Martin taking the first crack at Bashir and, like, strangling him and all that. All cool under Nelson's watch. Nelson's like, this is cool about
let
me.
Him rough him up.
Nelson's, like, the most laid back about all this stuff ever.
He's so chill. And you know what? The whole time, and all the way through the end of the episode, just Nelson's so chill.
Yeah.
And you don't know. You're like, is he a good guy or is he bad? Like, I just don't know because he's so chill. He's so in control. Like, we've yet to see him just blow his top.
Yeah. I don't know. I always
and
took
I like
him.
That.
Like, when you find out that he helped, when he was, like, talking to Sonya and they helped Martin, then you kind of take him to be a good guy from that point, I think.
Yeah, I don't know. Part of me still was kind of like, he's maybe, you know, it could be perceived as helping, but maybe he's just covering his own ass.
I'm
which
sure
is what's,
all...
you know, everybody's, you're just double guessing.
Well, I'm sure he's also covering his own ass, but I mean, I think everyone
his
wants
own
to.
His asset. Ayo, legend.
Martin is his asset,
there
by the
go.
Way. Boom. So then they turn it around, though, with Bashir. Turns out that they know about his daughter, Samara, and they know exactly where she is,
yeah.
And they threaten to kill her because Sean Bean just don't give a funk.
He doesn't. And you call it the desert code, an eye for an eye?
Yeah.
And the guy's like, you wouldn't kill him, you're FBI, come on! he put stuff in a guy's eye and killed him, so I think he'll go after anyone.
Yeah.
This Detective Odom.
Yeah, all you have to say is like, well, maybe I'll go undercover. Oh!
Oh, right, then it's completely justified.
Yeah, basically
justified.
Is what
I'm
it is.
I'm a legend. I killed a million people, it doesn't matter.
Yep, exactly. So we find out that it's Arcadia that leaked Martin's FBI through Bashir. So now we get, again, that Arcadia involvement that we have as an audience know.
Right.
So Arcadia is who he knows about, but he doesn't know where the hell Hassan has gone, because Hassan's actually smart and doesn't unlock up his people that he's torturing and who are also special agents who are killers.
Yeah.
Yeah. So... that is where Hassan is. But we get this break in the action with Jason Shaw, who's the head of Arcadia. Jason Shaw, who's not heading Arcadia.
Virax.
He's the Virax. The CEO of Virax. But they find that out. They find out that Jason Shaw also has involvement with Arcadia.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so we find out that Jason Shaw is this important guy. CEO of Virax. He's somehow involved with Arcadia. So he's a really important character who... anyone who watched the finale knows exactly who he is, but...
Right, and he's got a ton of money. He had great lines, too, in there. And I just really like how this show is paralleling, like, what's going on in topics right now. Anything political, or even if anything, like, people out there are like, oh, the government's all about money at the end of the day. You know, whichever way you feel, this show is a nice way of writing it into the storyline. And he had... I can't find it. Where did it go? Anyways, he had a great line basically saying that, you know, sovereign powers, it's dictated by who has the money. It has nothing to do with anything else. There's no such things as borders anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and there is this ongoing mentality of that in you know, the nation. You hear it more and more in conversations. Not the water cooler. I'm just saying that, you know, it was very relevant.
Yeah,
this whole scene,
absolutely.
Plot, dialogue.
Right, which I think, actually, that's a slightly different scene, but that's cool. We
can
talk about this scene, too. Yeah, this was the episode where they find out who Jason Shaw was.
Sorry.
But it's all good.
Right.
It's all good. So, Sean Bean, or Martin, I mean, we don't know who the hell his real name is, so... basically, he grills into Nelson if he worked for Virax, and finally, Nelson admits that, yes, he worked for Virax. He was a WITSEC operator, I believe, who would make people disappear, and that's what Nelson's job was, and he basically was assigned to make Martin disappear, and Martin Odom is a legend. He admits all that. He won't say if Sonya's involved, but it's pretty obvious that by his body language that she was, and they refuses to answer and ask yourself.
And then, too, you wonder if he wasn't saying, like, obviously let her tell you, but then maybe if he was so angry at Sonya, he wouldn't have that... motivation, that passion, that fury to go save her. So you kind of wonder if he held back too, just to make sure that he could recover this agent and kid.
Yeah.
Out of the field.
Yeah. I don't know.
I think he still would have saved him. He's a good guy.
Yeah, I think he would have saved him. I think it was just like from Nelson's viewpoint, this is your wife, and
you deal with it.
Right.
I've dealt with this enough.
Or just like, you know, like it should be something for her to say, really.
Let the woman that speak.
Yeah. Yeah. That should be the way to find out. So Aiden, the little badass he is, as we talked about before, took the phone from, noticed the phone, took it from Sonya's phone, and he remembers that the password is her birthday, 7205.
Which because you and I were like, wait, July 20th, 5. She's looking good to be that old. Or 1972 May. Are we thinking?
1972. Oh, okay. 72.
Like 1972
May.
7205.
Okay. I was thinking like, oh, it was obviously the 72nd of May is her birthday.
Clearly.
Clearly.
Clearly. Or she was born in the 5th of the 72nd month.
Yeah.
Right.
Right. 72-05. Yeah,
right,
it's the Mayan calendar that doesn't even, I think, doesn't even have that Mayan month.
But that was weird. Why not just make it 0572?
Yeah.
Why they have to do 7205? Minor detail.
No.
Just saying, I'm sure
even
a lot of people
0572
thought
that. Is like... maybe it's 2057 that she was born in the future.
She's amazing.
We wrap around phone. Okay, anyways. Yeah, he sends out and texts need help to Martin's phone, and then that's able to be picked up by Maggie, who picks up, and then they send Martin out, who's on a mission to destroy with Rice and Crystal.
Which that scene kind of felt a little bit too like when Martin Odom, you know, was freed from his captors. It felt a little like it just kind of like was like, okay, quick, we have to figure out a way to get them freed out of the house. It just seemed too simple when everything else had been so complicated. But hey, they got him free. We can move on with the storyline, I guess.
Yeah, basically. And just, you know, play some cool music.
Yeah. Guys, I'm not sure what to do with the scene. Just put some good music in.
Then, like, yeah, it was a really quick scene for what was, like, such a huge moment, really. Or what had been built up so much at this point. It was just, like, just goes in, extracts them, kills the bad guys.
It seemed very simple and diluted down.
Yeah, very much so. But they had more with this episode to do, which would become much bigger. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, quickly goes in, kills Azan, extracts her. He wants to make sure that his family's with someone that he knows in a safe house. Mm-hmm. So he pulls Agent Rice, who he now seems to trust. Yeah. So he trusts Agent Rice at this point. So bonding.
Some guy bonding. Yeah. When they pretended to be dishwasher repairmen from a few episodes ago.
That's exactly where the bonding happened.
That's where the bonding happened.
And then the shoe stuff.
Yeah. Bonding over a man who's hanging in a closet.
Right, exactly. So this is where we get the Jason Shaw of Urex scene with exactly what you talked about. But we also find out other important character here, Conrad Tomlin.
Yes.
Very important character who's going to come back in the finale episode that happened tonight anyways. But yeah, Conrad Tomlin, a really important character who Jason Shaw is meeting with. They really seem to like the exact same diner or spot or wherever they meet at. So if they could ever figure out where that's at, that's where to be.
That's where to be. That's where all the terrorists are, apparently. American terrorists.
Yeah, American terrorists, which is a nice little twist there.
Right, and once again, I'm not saying I'm in or without this, but saying how, like, you know, a lot of conspiracies are out there that, you know, American terrorist plots on U.S. soil that's done by Americans. A lot of people rumored that around the Boston marathons. Yeah. You know, it's conspiracy, it's out there. But again, the writers pulled from what people are already buzzing about out in the, you know, the country, and they've pulled it right, and they've put it into a script.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, this is based off of a book, sir.
Right, and it's off a book, but it's paralleling it, you know what I mean? Like, some shows that are written about on books, it's not completely paralleling it.
Oh, okay, I wasn't sure how much it
By the way,
was.
Speaking about books, the very first episode, when McCombs gave him that book, that storyline was just dropped. We've never, I think once it was referenced again.
No, we got with it was about the folded over flaps on the pages.
Yeah, but that's it?
That was it. That's all the book was those folded over page, like, numbers.
I kind of wanted more.
That's all it was.
That's
That's
what's written this
The
book.
Dog ears.
Yeah, I guess. All right.
That
all
was
right.
it.
All
so,
right,
yeah.
I'll let it rest.
But you know who won't let things rest? Nelson Gates.
No,
who
he
wants
won't.
A meeting.
Wants a meeting
or
now.
Or everyone has to go meet. So, Crystal trying to interrogate Martin about everything, and Martin still won't answer questions. As they go and have the meeting, everyone's involved with Nelson Gates meeting the superiors, who are going to be completely ignoring Prince Fayeen. The director wants the DCO off of the case, and everybody in the DCO is absolutely pissed off because no justice is happening.
Right, complete cover-up.
Right.
And that Agent Malloy, she ruffles my feathers.
It's a strange cover-up because it's like, who are they covering up exactly at this point when they could just, like, it's basically they're covering up Prince Fayeen maybe because they don't want a war or they don't want this, like, that would be my assumption.
Right, and but I'm sure something there is somehow linked back to the whole Virax storyline and the government cover-up, like the greater good. That's a continuing theme. Who knows?
Yeah, but
maybe
it's definitely
next season.
It's definitely
maybe.
Some fishy stuff going on with that they don't want to call it Prince Fayeen for it. So really, and Hughes just happens to be with the Arcadia, and who's also now connected to Virax. So those are the big connections there.
Money, money, money. Good thing I have none of it. That means I'm not evil.
Exactly.
Yes.
Me too. That means you can trust us. Unless we're going to be given a lot of money, but we wouldn't say it.
I have no money to give. Sorry to disappoint, friends.
I said if we're given it at some point. So, Crystal goes to meet with her father, which is apparently we get this other storyline, which that Crystal and her father have some sort of tension, and her father's also was in the military in the past.
Of course, now that we know the Crystal character and you see her dad, you're like, of course, military girl, yeah. Because dad was in the military. Well, naval, I think, actually.
Yeah, is that?
Either way, you just know that she had a dad that's strong, and she's bullheaded, and she's probably her, you know, father's daughter, and they butt heads because they're so much alike.
Got it. Okay, I was like, I don't think about those things.
Just saying. Of course, she's got a tough, stern dad. And I don't know, it was kind of an interesting way to get the information out, bring in a new character for that moment.
Yeah, so we find out about Operation Fire, which we can go ahead and talk about, I suppose. This is apparently the worst cover-up in military history. It was a friendly fire operation that went wrong, where apparently, and we find out a lot more about it, but all we find out about this point is that 400 people died in friendly fire. And that
was an entire platoon.
Right, and the entire thing was covered up. So, worst military...
Horrific, absolutely horrific.
Yeah, absolutely horrific. So that is what Operation Raining Fire is, and why it was completely covered up and wiped from the records. Mm-hmm. So, another end of the spectrum, Martin is meeting with DCO boss, or the one of the, or Nicholas Spiller. I just wasn't sure who he was at first.
You know,
so Nicholas Spiller.
I wrote, old dude who used to wear blue tie first episode with blue eyes. Bad, 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 bad.
That's nice.
Spiller.
Perfect note.
I'll trust him.
And you were absolutely right on your instinct. But he's the deputy director.
Deputy.
So that is his title, as we saw on one of the cards. They had his name on it.
Oh, yeah, his little placard on his desk.
Yeah, a little placard. So Martin meeting with a gun at the meeting, and he thinks that this is who he was made by. It was someone on the inside, obviously, and we know that, and he thinks it was Nicholas Spiller. And then Spiller kind of, like, does a little loop around and be like, hey, I'm on your side, bud. And I've been tracking Virex for 5 years. I want to bring them down, and I want you on my side.
And there's this guy, Cameron. You got to find him.
Yeah, you need to find Cameron, man. Yeah. Cameron, yeah.
Did anybody else think, as soon as he brought that up, that this, so, you know, later on, not to get ahead, but as when we get to the whole Cameron, character, wondering, ooh, who is this? Maybe he's a good guy that's just, they're going to put Martin Odom after just to take him out.
I didn't think that he was a good guy per se, but I did think that was
right. Like, he had information that they needed to be silenced, and they were going to let Martin Odom kill him.
Yeah, I definitely thought it was like something was fishy with it. Like, I didn't think it was a real, like, something seemed wrong and off about it. Like, I still didn't trust Nicholas Spiller.
Can't trust him. He's got blue eyes.
We're both right.
So do we. There are a lot of blue eyes in this episode, and all those people with blue eyes tend to be bad. They were bad, bad people.
So my eyes have a grayish tint to them. You know, that's the trustworthy part to it. So, yeah, that deputy director, though, going to become a huge character. And we also find out about Ensign, which is owned by Virex. So, yeah, and then John Cameron, obviously that character who is then first started by him. So Arcadia...
A.K.A. Chase. If you guys are
Chase.
Trying to remember, it's the one with the Chase symbol.
Remember, keep that in mind. Arcadia equals Chase, therefore bad. I mean, I didn't say anything.
Not the bank, but they have the same logo. Looks very much suspiciously like
Chase. So the head of Arcadia, who we'd seen before, who helped out with the entire issues from a couple episodes ago with Bashir Hassan and Prince Fayeen. This head now is meeting with Jason Shaw. Totally knows things aren't good.
Oh, that was a great scene, too. Yeah. And, like, they're shooting guns. There's this nice parallel. And, like, everyone's already on edge, and he's sweating.
Yeah.
His bow tie, it must be too tight.
Definitely. He knows that this isn't good.
This is bad. These are two bad dudes.
Right. So, basically, all this is... So, you know, someone's got to take the blame for everything that goes wrong, and he is the man to take the blame. So, Bashir is being painted. He tells them that what he's doing is having Bashir being painted as this zealot who is completely alone. So then we find out that it really is a cover-up started by these organizations, Arcadia and
Virex. Right? Yeah.
So that is, in fact, what it is. And, Thomason, who's also there, he's going to take over a little bit.
Yeah, just a little. He's just going to help you out.
Just a little bit. He'll help shoot you in the head. In the back of the head, so your brains explode.
I loved it. And it was like nice pacing of the big, sweaty guy's head. And then all of a sudden, that's my gunshot.
You know, if this was on HBO, they would have shown it, though.
They would have shown it, right. But it's TNT. But so, you know.
I mean, they don't know gore. They know drama.
Ah, that's good. That's right. Yes.
HBO knows gore and boobs.
They do. And the F-bomb. Very well.
But
that's why I pay a lot of money to watch it. But not drama. TNT has drama.
Yeah, exactly.
We shoot people in the back of the head in a very artistic scene.
Yeah.
Can you call it artistic? There were ducks. I hope no ducks were actually hurt.
No ducks were harmed in the making of the show. I don't know. I didn't see that.
They were probably actually, like, what, computer graphics?
Probably.
Yeah. Don't worry, guys. No ducks were hurt.
Or they have footage that they... I don't know. Maybe they just have footage that they're allowed to use.
I don't know. Moving on.
Martin Odom. Heading to the safe zone, to classified.
Yeah.
We don't even know where it is.
I love that. We don't even want the audience to know.
It's just safe zone somewhere. And Rice is there hanging out with the family. So Rice is coming close with the family now.
It's nice. Playing rummy. Yeah. Little gin rummy with the old fam.
And Aiden just a little badass again, cheating, which I guess is the badass thing to do.
Manipulating. He's getting ready for his future.
Go ahead and go cheat, kids. Badass thing to do. Yeah. So, Martin finally approaches Sonya about the truth, but he can't handle the truth.
Can't.
You want the truth?
I do.
You can't handle the truth!
You're right.
This was actually a Tom Cruise scene.
That was good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I followed. I got you.
I know you followed. Anyways. So, Martin approaches her, and she doesn't... She starts breaking down and says that she doesn't want to say it because she's afraid that
he won't love her.
Just like that.
But it was a good scene. I dug it. I'm all about it, right?
Because
you know she was trying to play it all cool, and he's like, "You have to tell me. I need answers, woman." You know. And then because you kind of, I mean, think about it. It's the person you're married to, you have a kid with, that you were in love with, and you're fighting for this marriage. All of a sudden, you're like, "Hold the phone. You're a legend." But then you know it was nice. She's like, "I did fall in love with you."
Yeah.
You, Martin Odom.
Bring it back to one of the first episodes this season where it was the scientist dad who had lied to his wife about his past and all that stuff, and then she found out that he'd been lying, so...
Is it okay? Is it okay to lie?
It's a little similar.
To the ones you love?
Not to the ones you love especially.
Officially, no, but unofficially, yes.
So, you know, looking to pick up Carrie over there, just, you know... Find out what she likes, and you can totally just
you can
lie
just
all you want.
Me. Especially if your name is Agent Rath.
Especially. So that's good advice for you kids back home. Lie. We're just following the theme of Aiden, actually.
It is.
Because we were talking about how Aiden's going to become a liar and cheater, so.
There we go.
There you go. Things to become, things to aspire to. Liar and a cheater. So that is when all of a sudden... shit hits the fan, and all of a sudden, their cover that's supposed to be there, it's gone.
Completely blown. He notices somebody's not out in the yard protecting.
Right, so something's up, and all of a sudden, he is called out to come outside, mm-hmm. and they are then attacked.
I gotta say this. I don't mean a nitpick. You guys know how I am with all the background stuff and like details. So you have these people coming in at night. When they have helmets on or night vision... Like, I just think if you're going
to
be covered from...
They don't have the technology. They can't afford
to.
It from the biggest military contractor.
They're like, military. They have to have it. Like, wouldn't they have big helmets on in case they get shot
I don't
in
know
the head?
If you know this, but the biggest military contractor in the U.S. doesn't have that kind of technology.
Well, let's get him on the phone, because I need to tell him he needs to wear a helmet.
All they have is, like, voice recognition technology and facial recognition and creation
but helmets,
technology.
But
helmets...
They ran out for the budget. Well, they would be alive if they had those on, just saying. Nice
shootout,
though.
Then you go for the neck, though.
True.
Martin, he's a really good shot, except for during this shootout, where all of a sudden he sucked at shooting.
He did. But you know what? Every time you ever watch a show and there's a big shootout and then the people leave the guns, what are you screaming at the TV? Pick up the gun! Pick up the gun! Martin Odom picked up the gun.
Yeah, no, that was
finally.
Cool.
Finally, I was like, yes!
But it's just
yes!
funny because all of a sudden he became a stormtrooper.
Yeah. Well, he's a badass.
Not in that sense. Stormtroopers are notorious for not being able to hit things.
True.
They can't shoot.
Like,
and it's just like, usually he's right on the dot. Right on the line. We've seen him as Legends, where he literally is the quick draw McGraw, shoots someone in the spot. Like, right away, and all of a sudden, he can't aim.
Maybe he was so high of an emotional adrenaline rush from Sonya confessing her love to him, like her real true love.
And he was just like,
he just couldn't shoot.
He's holding the assault rifle. He's just like, I'm not used to this gun. Like, give me a handgun, and I can shoot that and aim, but this gun, I can't aim.
Clearly, that's the issue. Well, there you go.
But Sonya then automatically going into her now former mode before,
mm-hmm.
where she was some sort of undercover agent, and quickly takes up the pace. Mm-hmm. Shoots her gun, but she gets shot herself.
In the heart. How perfect. Aww. And she came out holding her heart. Oh,
what a parallel to the story.
I was like, oh, it's kind of cheesy, but I like it.
So, in the ambulance, instead of comforting her, he continues to interrogate her.
Yeah.
He's like, well, I mean, really, though, this is his, if she dies, that's his last chance to find out.
Completely. You might as well ask. I'm surprised he wasn't, like, pressing hard on her chest, like, tell me. And then, like,
they're like, sir, actually, can you press less hard?
Sorry about that.
Yeah. So she breaks down and admits everything that Martin Odom was in MI6,
mm-hmm.
and that she was a CIA agent told to recover someone from MI6, and that was all she knows.
And to protect him from that day forth.
Exactly. And that it was a lie, but it became real. I fell in love with you.
With
Carrie.
You. With me.
You.
With the real me.
You. And then she quit the agency there. She quit the CIA to have a real life with him.
Because she really was in love with him. That's a big thing to give up your career that you've busted ass to get into. You know what I mean? Like, she had to be pretty hardcore and then to give it all up.
Yeah, to have a family with him.
Pretty honorable.
And keep the lie going.
And yes, that too. So yeah, that was very convenient.
She kept on trying to find a time up to bring it up, but she just couldn't. So
no time in 10 years to bring it up. Huh.
But she doesn't know his real name either. But she says he was in the MI6, whereas everything we heard before is that he was part of Virax.
Mm-hmm.
So that was where the episode ended, and where I had my brilliant theory.
What is your theory?
Which was exactly right. Which was that he was an undercover for Virax, and he actually was part of MI6, which is essentially Britain's version of the CIA, and he was undercover for them on Virax, but we find that out anyways. So.
Global teamwork. Way to go, Dave.
Whatever.
Way to go, Dave. Hey, thumbs up. Way to go.
So let's move on to the next episode.
Yeah.
And what good timing. It's like 30 minutes in, we finished up wrapping the full episode. Bam, let's go on for the next episode.
Better hang on, because this episode's juicy.
Wham, Sonya in the hospital. This is flashback, where we find out that Sonya shoots a guy coming to kill Martin and William and Otto. And this is where we get the line that he heard, I'm your wife.
Mm-hmm.
It was as she was wheeling him out after shooting someone.
I wonder if she just made that up on the spot. Well, she had to. They said, just protect him, so she came up with it.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Well, yeah, like, Nelson did say, stick with the script. He says something along those lines to her.
Right, true.
She was like, what should I say or what should I do? And he goes, stick with the script. And then she goes, I'm your wife.
Oh, that's right. She did call him.
So I wonder if it still seemed like could have been that. Yeah.
But she had no idea she'd fall so in love with him. He is dashing. And he has an accent.
Sean Bean. Ah, Sean Bean. Except for when he was Boromir and kind of an asshole.
For which one?
Boromir in Lord of the Rings. Kind of an asshole.
I was like, wait, what legend was that? I don't remember.
Except for when he was a legend Boromir. And,
what? Did I miss his episode?
That's the thing is, like, every single past role he had was just another legend. Every acting role.
It's a show within a show.
Exactly. I'll
tell you what.
So Aiden looks surprisingly happy when he walks into the hospital.
Oh, right, because now they're present time. Right. That was a nice parallel between like the two hospital scenes. That was nice.
There's a lot of hospital scenes in this show, I noticed. A
lot. Well, you know, health and costs and all these days.
Let's call it ER Part 2.
There we go.
So, yeah, he's surprisingly chipper, and he goes up to Dad, catch them.
Daddy, catch them, please.
Please,
Daddy.
If only he got that British accent, too, then he'd be winning. He's scoring all the ladies.
He's working on it.
He's a badass and with British accents. It's only... What else do you need?
It's a matter of time.
What else do you want? So Crystal comes and finally confronts Martin again and by saying, I spoke to my dad. He knows about the daddy issues.
Did hell freeze over?
What?
So they must all know they have a broken relationship, Crystal and her father.
Exactly. So everyone knows that that's a big deal. Big deal.
It is.
So she tells him everything that we found out, that it was a giant cover-up, and he admits to her that Martin Odom is a legend.
And that he's the man who knows too much.
Yeah.
Except he forgot. Yeah, there's so many quotable lines. I have so many quotes. I'm going to tweet them all out later.
Just start, like, just whole rapid-fire tweet. Rapid-fire, go. Bam, 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 bam. So Nicholas Spiller holding a meeting now.
Old guy.
Yeah,
bad old guy with blue eyes.
Batman blue eyes.
Mm-hmm.
That's always because they both start with the letter B. Bad blue. So the Bureau is compromised, and it's because of this John Cameron guy. So again, we have to go after John Cameron. That is the guy to go after.
He is bad news.
Very bad news. So Tomlinson meets with Jason Shaw. And Tomlin's kind of troubled.
Mm-hmm.
And Jason Shaw says, don't worry, we're using John Cameron. So he kind of builds it up for the audience that John Cameron's this person that they're using.
Like, he absolutely exists. And that's when he had the great quote about the sovereignty is dictated by those with means.
Yeah.
Fortune favors the bold. Quotes.
That is definitely a good one.
But again, if you got money, it kind of constitution versus money, which a lot of the show, especially at the end, we'll get to it. Just a lot of it just became such a political show at the end.
Yeah, definitely.
Very
really
relevant.
Did.
I like relevant writing.
It's it's really quick paced too, the show. Especially like these two episodes were really quick, like revealing things, which I liked as well.
And it was done in a way that seemed natural. It wasn't like, I have to get all this information out really fast to you, blah, blah, blah. It was justified in when characters reveal info.
And also when you think about the episode before the finale, which would be episode 9, I guess.
The penultimate episode.
They also did a good job of transitioning from the both storylines where it made sense into this bigger, larger storyline, too. So you got to give the writers credit for that.
Well done. Applause.
Just don't have them write a scene about a hostage who's tied up and then...
And is a badass serial killer.
And then the people are like, hey, let's untie him.
Because he's going to kick your ass.
As long as you don't give the writers that scene to handle, then they write good stuff.
Spot on.
So, let's see. So we get so at this point, I think I messed up my notes. Hold on a second.
There was a lot going on. We were getting very excited watching this episode. They definitely had parallel stories, though.
Yes.
For what was going on and what we saw. Well, then they went to the morgue, and we had the ranger, right?
Oh, my notes aren't in the right spot. I wrote no facial recognition, and I was just seeing facial recognition. I was like, this isn't the right scene for the facial stuff.
That comes in later. But
thank
you. Right. Yeah,
so they're taking pictures at the morgue of all the guys. And we find out the guy had plastic surgery, like, was really trying to cover his identity, all that. Like, major plastic surgery like that. Man, that's a lot of pain that you got to go through for that.
It's a hell of a facelift.
Like, I hope you got to, like... stay at home, eat some ice cream for like a month straight, you know, like just relax.
That's what you thought. Oh gosh, I hope you recovered okay with ice cream.
Like, man, that plastic surgery, like, hope you have some good recovery time. So they use this infrared thing that is basically
an infrared filter on a camera. Does that exist? Does that? I tried to find it in the apps store and
probably
I did
not.
Find it. Okay.
But in Maggie's world, it exists.
And if Maggie says it does,
then
it does.
Definitely exists. So. Then they find this secret hidden tattoo, hidden code, and they find that this guy has it, and then Martin has the code too, and it turns out that any VRX employee has the same tattoo and code. So again, trying to string you along the fact that Martin is part of VRX.
And you know what? It was,
even though we get the MI6 thing in that previous episode, but...
Right. Yeah. And it was Nicholas Spiller, the old guy, the bad guy.
Yeah.
He's the one that told him what the code meant.
Right.
So... either he knew they would discover, or he's just trying to stay two steps ahead to keep the story moving the way he wants it
to. Yeah, yeah. So, he did say he'd been researching VRX for 5 years, so it's kind of justified, like, oh, yeah, right. I know things about VRX.
Look, it's in a folder. I'm so organized.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, that's when they find out the guy's Trent McFadden.
A Green Beret.
Yeah, a Green Beret, a Merc. And they then go to this apartment in Echo Park. And they find it's John Cameron's apartment.
Dun, dun, dun.
They find a sniper rifle, some burner cash, and as they are now in this apartment, they get a call from Cameron to Martin's phone.
Oh,
with
no.
Also no question about how they had Martin's phone number, too.
Nothing. But I got a question for you, Dave. Do you like scary movies?
I'm trying to do. I can't do the
like
voice.
You're Fleming. It was like the scary movie voice for the supposed Cameron's voice.
Well, I think it's like the Saw voice
on the phone.
It's the Saw voice. I have to call you, and then just pick up the.
But this is some kind of practical joke. It's not funny.
What are you trying to say?
We're just saying he had a very scary voice, reminiscent of the movie Scary Movie.
He exactly had the voice for Saw.
Or Saw.
He really did. It was
he
the
did.
Saw voice.
It was very gritty.
It was like it was such a stereotypical horror voice that we both looked at each other like, really? Is this show really stooping to that? That's really what it was. Like I think that was at least what I was thinking in my head when I looked at you, Kara. Is like, is this show stooping to that stupid voice?
Yeah. But then we realized that later in the show.
That there's actually a good reason for it, which is cool. So I'm glad they actually had a reason for it, because at first I was really disappointed.
We were hating on the moment. We were like, what? No. By the way, and they were saying how there's plotting for an assassination, you know, looking at his apartment. Again, back to relevant, this show takes place in Los Angeles area. Biden is in town right now. Vice President Biden is in town right now. So, you know, that's like some major news. Saw the motorcade go by today. So assassinations, I'm sure, high alert for the city. And then the show just happens to air on the same day.
What?
Bum, bum, bum.
Bigger news, though. How the hell is an apartment that nice in Echo Park?
That is exactly it.
That's the real question.
That is...
I'm saying high five!
No apartment like that in Echo Park. No.
Cool. Okay.
Or that clean.
Seriously, really, the cleanliness is the biggest part. So they find out that these bills that were there, thanks to Rice, who happens to know this, bills were part of a cash shipment to Iraq that just went missing, over $1
billion.
$1 billion.
Never gets old.
So Virek stole it, and Cameron was the prime suspect.
What? Whoa. Cameron again.
So this guy, Cameron, prime subject over the stealing $1 billion, also part of Virex who stole it. So this actually is weird to me. This conflicts with something later on. So apparently if Rice knows that Virex stole $1 billion, why is Virex then considered good guys to all the higher-ups?
Maybe the higher-ups are all in on it. Oh, you mean at the end of the episode?
Yeah.
I have a theory on that.
Okay. Because, like, it's weird that now Rice, even, like, in his lower department, is like, Virex stole $1 billion. And there's this prime suspect, but then, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, mm-hmm. He starts grilling Martin, like, were you in on this?
Were you?
Were you the one? Because I have your phone, and I'm calling you right now, and I just happen to be there. You're in my apartment. Finally got the voice. It took a while.
There you go.
It took a while.
It's good.
I have a nasally voice. It's hard. It's easier for me to go up in the nasal region, but yeah. Going low is very hard.
There you
so,
go.
So, they go to the motel.
What? Did you see the motel room number?
666. Because anyone who calls you like this is obviously going to be the hotel called 666.
That's right. The devil. The devil himself entered that room. And it was a blue door. Devil with a blue door.
I gotta say, like, even like the 666 on the wall thing is kind of like a... This seems like a little bit...
It was kind of... And why was it necessary? You know, somebody had like a can of spray paint on set. Was like, oh my God, you guys, I got a great idea. Because you could have just left it as 6.
Right. I mean, the thing is, like, that makes it stand out to a point of like, this has to be a trap.
Yes.
I mean, like...
Yes.
Yeah, like, it's such a trap.
Set detail.
Yeah.
Too much this time.
A little bit too much. If, I'm my mind is going to poop right now because I want to call it the Star Wars character who goes, it's a trap! General Akbar. If General Akbar were here, he would be
Akbar.
Having a heart attack right now.
Admiral
Akbar. Excuse me. See, that's why I was having a brain fart. If Admiral Akbar were here, he would just be blowing his lid off in, like, annoyance about how obvious of a trap it was.
Maybe he'll join the cast next season.
Maybe.
Maybe.
He would just pop up and go, it's a trap! Yeah, so it's just, like, such an obvious trap because of the 666 thing. Like, that to me is just like, come on.
Come on. Or the car that didn't have a tire that was sitting right out front.
Yeah, like, oh, that's a good getaway car.
I mean, it was down to the disc, the brakes.
Oh, I want to investigate that further, though, from Martin, direct quote.
That's the truth.
So, Martin, that's the truth.
That's the truth.
So, Martin goes, they all go to investigate further the crack team of Crystal, Rice, and Martin. Mm-hmm. Now, it turns out Rice should never be a driver, even though his dad ran an auto dealership.
He didn't teach him how to drive. He only taught him how to work on cars. Oh, here's a fun fact, though. The stunts. The stunts this season were very impressive, especially these last two episodes. Love stunts because it's all part of that set detail that I love. So here's a fun detail. We looked it up. We're pretty sure this is correct. The stunt coordinator, the person that coordinates all the stunts, does the directing of the stunts, like the flipping of the car, was actually Eric Norris, which is Chuck Badass himself Norris. So Chuck Norris's son, Eric Norris, was a stunt coordinator for Legends.
So there you go, a little awesome nugget of information. Yeah, that's really cool.
Yeah.
So he transferred his badassery from father to son.
He did.
Just like Crystal's father. So Crystal.
Oh, that's deep. Oh, and then they're going to transfer it to Aiden, Sonia.
Yeah, exactly.
This is really
like
is a family
ultra
show.
Ultra badassness right there. Both Aiden and both Sonia and Martin. Wow. Aiden's going to be a true killer.
Maybe he'll know how to drive better than Agent Rice, though, because he done flipped that car.
So, yeah. So it turns out it's a trap. Agent Rice getting away. Mm-hmm. It's an absolute trap. So, yeah. Rice trying to get away, flips over the car because he can't drive. You only work on cars, and they all get knocked out. And as they get knocked out, it turns out the entire thing was just to take Martin, not kill him.
Hmm.
They actually take him, which is really odd. And that's what I was wondering the whole time was, why don't they just kill this guy?
Right. And I think Agent Rice even had a thing like, this is the second time they've snatched him up. Why?
Yeah.
Why don't they just take him out? So even Rice is onto it.
They say this was the second time they snatched him up, or this was the second time they attempted to.
Right. But they did take him, right?
Did they? I thought this was the second time they attempted to, because before it was just the actual, like...
Well, like, at the LAX when he took him. So yeah. It's the second time they've kidnapped him, so and it's just nice when
Martin's
the character's
just down on his luck.
He needs better technology. Maggie, come on. Can't keep him safe.
Yeah, so... Nelson wants to speak to Nicholas, and he wants the priority to be finding Martin, whereas... Mm-hmm. Nicholas, being the higher up, refuses to budge. And he's like, well, I'm the boss, so I'm too bad.
Yeah, too bad. And I like the little conversation in the elevator.
Yeah, Nelson actually, like, standing up, too.
I like Nelson.
Balls.
He's
yeah.
grown. I kind of was wondering if Maggie, because, you know, she kind of gave him a look as he went in the elevator. I was wondering if she was going to be like, boop, 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 and then bring up, like, the camera and the elevator.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, yeah. Or she, like, Beyonce somehow she, like, locks the elevator, so she's like, oh, elevator stuck.
And then she comes over the speaker.
Tell the truth.
Tell the truth. This is Maggie.
Tell the truth.
That didn't happen.
My name is John Cameron and Maggie.
Vurex Operations Bunker is where we're at next.
Dun, dun,
dun. And then all of a sudden we get this flashback to Basra, Iraq, where it turns out that we see Jason Shaw's there, Martin's there, and like we get all those flashbacks there to... Martin flashback. It was just a flashback to him getting thrown into prison. Mm-hmm. And then Jason Shaw shows up in modern day... And starts admitting everything. So this is the typical bad guy, I'm going to explain everything to you moment.
Just in case you were confused.
Right, just in case you hadn't figured it all out yet with the whole stealing the money thing. That is, in fact, what we were covering up. And let me tell you that right now, as opposed to just doing what I want to do. Let me sit you down and confess.
Right, because I'm so good at being bad, I'm just going to get it all out in the open, because I'm never going to get caught.
So I'm going to tell you instead of you discovering it on your own.
That's
right. So like I said, actually, it's kind of, that's like Mr. Monologue.
TV show.
Now that I think about it, I'm like, that's actually kind of bad writing. When they have to have the bad guy do the monologue.
True.
Like, that's such like a TV trope that people, you always make fun of.
They tried to make it somehow justified his ongoing of confession, but...
Yeah, so it's just like, he really had no reason to tell Martin any of this. He could have, like, left him in the dark.
You know what I think it is? I think it's ego, and I'm so good at what I did, and I pulled it all off, and he's convinced that Martin Odom's going to die, or he's going to go away, and he's so arrogant, and he's gotten so caught up in his own scheme that they confess.
Yeah.
I think maybe, but you're right. Again, it goes right along, like, we've seen this storyline before.
Right, so... Hey, if you want to be a future bad guys out there, stop confessing your entire plots to the hero.
You're welcome. Right?
You're welcome.
Hashtag tips on how to be a bad
guy.
First,
become a cheater and become an awesome at cheating and awesome at lying. And then once you become a bad guy, another tip for you, don't monologue to the hero.
No monologue. To the hero. But you know what? I did think, again, it kind of bothered me when they said that they caught Martin Odom taking pics of the money.
Yeah.
And that whole scene. I was like, really? Would he be that sloppy to get caught taking pics?
Apparently he is. MI6 training wasn't good enough. So we do find out that Martin was, in fact, an MI6 spy.
Confirmed.
Mm-hmm. He was working for Vurex, but as a spy for MI6.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, they started torturing him, beating the crap out of him to... because, as you said, they found him taking pictures of the money. So basically, he helped kill and steal this $1 billion. Essentially to expose them.
And what a reveal.
Yeah.
Massive reveal.
So he actually was there as Agent Rice had been like, were you there? It turns out he was and was one of the guys who killed the two men at the car.
Did he kill or he just stood there and let him kill?
I think he did one of the bullets was him and one of them was Jason.
Was it?
Or maybe he just watched. But
it still makes him an accessory to it.
But I mean, to me, it was like, it's for that greater good of like, I mean, when you're going undercover, you have to stay undercover. You can't just all of a sudden pop out of undercover like, I'm an entire bunker of people who are going to go kill me if I break cover right now.
Right.
So like, he couldn't break cover at that moment, but they steal $1 billion. He actually, for him, this was the moment where I can take pictures. I can actually finally expose them because I know they're bad. And it's all for MI6. And he gets the crap beaten out of him. And it turns out another kind of conspiracy theory thing is, hey, let's go back to what was topical 10 years ago and Saddam Hussein's weapons of mass destruction. Yeah, Saddam's weapons of mass destruction. Turns out that they actually did exist. And it was all Vurex who took these weapons of mass destruction.
Now we know.
I've been wondering for those past 10 years. Turns out it's all Vurex.
I'll let them know that we've resolved
it. They will get on it.
Yeah, sure they will.
They absolutely will. They'll use the legends as fact. So it turns out it was Virax took Saddam's weapons of mass destruction so they could use them as leverage for various things, because that would definitely look good for America to not find the weapons of mass destruction. And,
yeah. But, well, Virax took it because power isn't free. It comes at a price. And then when you have weapons of mass destruction, you have leverage and a bunch of other things that he rattled off.
And Mr. I guess the other idea, too, is even though they were the military contractor for America, they weren't necessarily representing American interests.
They didn't
care. To them, you're right. And to them, it's like, I don't care what it makes the U.S. government look like that we took these weapons of mass destruction. And like, hell, if they want these weapons of mass destruction to be found, they can pay us for it, would probably be the idea.
Exactly. Yep.
So
it's all money.
Right. It's all about that money.
Money, money, money.
So now that they have $1 billion, they can do whatever the hell they want. Until our friend Kyle Evans,
what?
From way back when, turns out he was actually a good guy, too.
And just so you remember, Kyle Evans was the guy who got killed and had the bag over his head.
Yeah.
Draw your memory.
He was actually, he was the one who was like a conspiracy theorist, also like, oh my God, what? Yeah, so really freaking out. So he actually busts out Martin Odom in Iraq, and turns out Operation Raining Fire.
Oh my God!
It was all Martin Odom who did it. He called it out, but he was thought he would probably end up dying from Operation Raining Fire.
Right, for the greater good.
Right. So it was actually what it all was, and nobody really knows because all of it's covered up, except for us as an audience. Is that this entire bunker is the Virax bunker of all of Virax? So to him, it was I can wipe out all of Virax, these weapons of mass destruction, WMDs. Everything.
It won't spread to the rest of the world, just an isolated incident.
Right, just have it all happen right here, right now, Fatboy Slim song, and just have all that happen in a moment, and then he will go down with it. He's willing to, basically, this would be suicidal. He's going to die from this, too.
He's dying for his country.
Yeah.
He's dying for multiple Britain, countries. He's dying for the world. Yeah. For the world.
So
that
he's
wiped
willing
out.
To lay this down. He calls it in, calls in this airstrike, and it is him who is behind this giant, horrible thing that happened that actually turns out to not be as horrible as we all think it is, because when you really think about it, it's all wiping out the bad guys. The entire bad guys. Everybody.
Everybody.
This is all the worst scum. Virax. But luckily, or not luckily, Jason Shaw survives this. And Martin survives this, and a bunch of people survive this, and Jason Shaw has been trying to get him back for 10 years because 400 of his men died. So Jason is absolutely pissed about this for some reason.
Do you think he's really trying to revenge his men, or he's just trying to revenge his own personal ego?
I think his personal ego.
Yeah.
And I think it's also just, like, the expenses. That's a lot of money.
Money. He lost his money.
He lost all of his stuff. So for 10 years, he's been wanting to kill Martin because that was all of his stuff. Yeah, so...
That's a lot of work. Here's my question, too. The grave was pre-dug, so apparently, I'm guessing, Jason Shaw was like, oh, we're going to kill him, so let's dig a grave. We'll throw him in it. So that's why it was already dug.
Yeah, that would be my guess. Like because they were torturing him probably to kill him.
Mm-hmm.
So, because he's that MI6 scum. So they're scanning Martin's face, scanning his voice for some reason that Martin doesn't know. But you kind of have an idea. I didn't know they would go do exactly that, but I sort of figured with what we've seen Maggie do, it'd be something similar with the voice recognition they were doing. So, turns out Martin Odom, big reveal, is John Cameron.
Dun, dun.
So, that guy who is suspected of stealing $100 billion, that's way
a lot
of money. $1 billion. I can't even imagine $1 billion. So, can you even imagine $100 billion?
Cannot.
But, so, turns out Martin Odom is John Cameron, or at least John Cameron was also a legend.
Right, so we still don't know who he is.
But big issue is that John Cameron is suspected by the U.S. government of stealing $1 billion for Virax. And not only that, but John Cameron is also just this bad dude who's on the loose. That's the one we keep on hearing about.
Mm-hmm.
So who is working for Virax, which is bad.
Mm-hmm.
So John Cameron, as we both said, is also a legend. So who is Sean Bean? I don't know. He's just Sean Bean.
He's a man with a moral dilemma.
So here's what's going to happen, Carrie. Let me lay it down for you.
Lay it down, Dave.
All right, so I'm going to have you, John, kill Dale Bennett, who's the director of the FBI.
No.
And I'm going to have it so it looks like you're the one who did it.
You're going to frame me?
I am going to frame you, and I'm going to tell you that I'm framing you.
Another monologue of confession?
Yes.
Bad guy?
So you know what I'm doing to you.
Okay.
All right, so now that you know, now I'm going to knock you out with a gross needle, and I'm going to...
What was it? Sodium thiopental?
Yeah, actually, I wrote it down, too.
I'm not a doctor.
shit.
I know. You guys thought I was a doctor this whole time.
So what's that operation that you're going to do after this?
Don't worry about it. Put ice on it.
Oh, okay. So we go to the Westwood. This is where at the Westwood Federal Building.
And that's real. There is a federal building in Westwood, California, which is right by UCLA.
Yeah.
So it's good.
I used to drive past
right across the street.
It's actually it's cool to me because I always kind of wondered about that building. Now I know. Apparently the FBI director is there in that building.
They're going to have to move now. They've been compromised.
Right. So
sorry, guys.
Sean Bean all of a sudden wakes up across the street. I can call him Sean Bean now because we don't know who the hell he is.
Confirmed.
We don't know his character. So
confirmed.
He wakes up across the street. They put the gun there. So basically he's in the location. And then they have it so John Cameron comes out. And they literally use that voice recognition and 3D recognition and make him say those lines from a couple weeks ago. Because we saw that in a preview a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
So I thought it was due to this storyline with Virax. Bam! Bam, bam, I was right about that, but I was also wrong, and that was something from the past, because I thought maybe it was something from Iraq that they pulled up, and it turns out it was something completely fake.
But you know what else? I definitely called it. I said that I think Martin Odom's character did something really bad pre-2004 car accident, waking up in the hospital. I honestly didn't think he was the guy that had the trigger pulled for the big of everyone dying, but... Well done. They kept that kind of on our wraps.
Although it was really bad, but it was also really good, too.
Right.
And we also get the confliction with Martin's character, where which we kind of glazed over, or I skipped over, which was him in the car with Crystal saying, am I a bad person?
Right.
And he's legitimately...
He's questioning his existence.
Yeah, he doesn't know who he is. He doesn't know what he did in the past.
And he's going to have to pay for it somehow.
Yeah, and then all the legends that he's been, as he admits, he's done some bad things.
And what's it for?
Yeah.
Is he really a good guy or bad guy? Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Nice. A nice, honest moment. Yeah.
So that was a good moment that we should have brought up. But,
Back to...
Huge framing on Sean Bean's character. I pulled the trigger knowing what I was doing. All that on the on-tape confession.
Mm-hmm.
The Crystal and Rice find him there, but essentially assist in his escape.
Mm-hmm.
So, at least now he's not found at the scene of the crime. At least I don't believe they said he was found at the scene of the crime.
No, but he's in the building, it seems, 100, 200 feet inside, because he wakes up, and then he walks out, he sees a gun, and this is the one time not to pick up the gun. He picks it up, was like, let me put my fingerprints all over it. And I'm sure they could have, but it's like, why would you pick up the gun this time? And then, of course, Agent Rice and Crystal show up. But you know what we don't know?
Yeah, I was thinking the exact same thing, too.
She told him to run.
Yeah.
So even in that moment when they basically are catching him red-handed, they know he's been set up.
They could have also taken the sniper rifle and maybe, because I don't think there was any mention of the sniper rifle. So, if Crystal and Rice were really, thinking ahead, they would have taken the sniper rifle and just not reported it or done something with it.
True.
So maybe that's what happened with the sniper rifle.
Speaking of sniper rifle, who pulled the trigger on that sniper rifle? That character was not revealed.
That's a good point. Maybe it was Jason.
Could have been Jason. I think it was Agent Rice. My tasty, beautiful Agent Rice. I really feel like that was him.
So you think that he's bad, too?
Yeah, I don't want him to be.
You think he's dirty? Well, it's weird that he knows the building. Well, okay, so that goes into your question.
But again, I could be totally wrong, but who pulled the trigger? That person is going to be, if it gets renewed next season, I'm saying it right now, I really think that person's going to be pivotal to the season's arc, storyline.
That also does pull up into the whole Vurex thing that we wanted to talk about, too, which we'll get to as we're getting to it. There's going to be a transition of leadership at the Bureau now after everything that's happening. So Nelson refusing to believe that Martin was responsible, but it doesn't matter. No one on the team thinks Martin's responsible. Crystal saying that she finds zero evidence in Martin's character. She absolutely doesn't believe it's Martin and stands up for him when she's at the FBI basically blaming Virax and saying Virax was involved. But then we get Jason Shaw's a personal friend of mine. He's a patriot and a personal friend of mine.
Right. And he got so heated over it. Would that happen when you're at that level? Wouldn't you be able to keep it between personal and work? But then again...
Yeah, so, he's the higher up, and he's I guess it's supposed to be I personally vouch for him because I'm higher up, so how dare you? But the thing is, and here's where my confusion with it is we found out that Virax, 10 years ago, stole $1 billion. Jason Shaw was the head of Virax. Hey, he's a patriot and personal friend of mine who still runs Virax, and we know this.
Mm-hmm.
So how? What even? What?
Well, probably because they paint him as a hero who survived it. Because remember, he got his back burned and his lung collapsed. So they're right. painting him as a hero. And he probably gave money or something. He obviously has access to money. He's probably in the pocket of all those people. So now you have this whole issue of all these like high-ups that are deep within. Everybody's got their finger in the honeypot. You know what I mean? I don't know. I mean, that's how else do you get somebody to be on your side anymore at that level?
It just seems like if everything money. That even like other people are like, oh, yeah, Vurex is bad. Vurex is not a good company. Even people like Rice have said like, oh, yeah, that's Vurex and they're bad. And Jason Shaw is still the head of Vurex. And they say that he's the head of Vurex, and we know he's the head of Vurex, but everyone's like, oh, yeah, Vurex is bad.
Right, and anytime something happens like that, you would be the head would be asked to step down.
Right.
Because it's just, it's too much. Step down, clear the slate.
Because everyone has been like, Vurex is bad, they do bad stuff. Like, even Agent Rice knows that Vurex is bad.
But Agent Malloy and, what's his name, Schiller, Blue Eyes, Bad Guy, Spiller.
Right.
They're obviously into covering things up, and they seem to outrank the DCO. Right. So I'm wondering if it's just been a massive cover-up this entire time.
Well, yeah, it's all cover-up upon cover-up upon cover-up.
It's like Legends, only for cover-ups.
Right. Maybe that's why it's really called Legends.
Dun, dun, dun. That's so deep and smarty pants of you.
It's almost Inception-ish, too.
It is. It really is.
It's like a cover-up within a cover-up within a cover-up. And you got to go into the deepest cover-up.
My head exploded.
Yeah, so Nelson, we find out, even though he has to now step down, DCO is officially closed.
How convenient.
Can you just do that? Apparently.
They can. They outrank him.
So DCO is just officially closed.
But they got him on a desk job to Nelson, keep him close.
Yeah, so Nelson's still going to have a gig, but he's... Yeah,
keep the enemies closer. Close.
Yeah, exactly. Friends close, enemies closer. Mm-hmm. So Nelson helping out Martin on the slide.
Very fugitive.
Yeah. Very much so.
Well, the Hoover Dam be in there at some point. And then we see Martin Odom.
And then they have to climb through like all those like dams and such.
Cool. Maybe the damn gift shop will be in there.
Yeah. any movie with Harrison Ford is a good movie. Except for some more recent ones. But a lot of movies with Harrison Ford are good movies. Back in the day. So, yeah. So Nelson is still going to be on Martin's side. We find out he's absolutely 100% with Martin. And, Crystal also completely refusing to back down and then finding out DCO shut down. So what's happening to Crystal now, too? Because that's her job.
But she's got a dad in high places. So you see, like, it's a nice wrap-up to a season, but you also see how this storyline could continue and escalate into another season because you see, like, this DCO, these, you know, they're going to all be painted as bad rogue agents versus, I guess, is it the Department of Justice?
Yeah.
Is that who that is? So it's going to be this, I mean... They're all going to have to go under.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Martin, it kind of wraps with Martin watching Aiden go to school with Sonya, and Sonya looking at the car, but probably knowing.
She has, I mean, if she's a legend and she knows the tactics, she has to know he's there.
Right. Well, I mean, this is like beyond a legend. He's a fugitive now. It's not even a legend.
He's about just, to skip that country.
And then, so he gets a passport from Nelson.
Yeah.
So he got. And then the episode wrapping with everything getting redacted. Crystal, I think, was getting redacted, right?
Everybody's going under.
Right, everyone's getting redacted. Everybody.
Is Agent Ryan?
And also we find out, too, that that turns out that Martin is now redacted from MI6.
So he doesn't exist.
Yeah.
He doesn't exist.
So.
And they're painting him as a fugitive. They're going to blame everything on him. And I liked at the end how it had Spiller taking his oath to be a good man, which we know he is not. And then you've got it. What? What? He's bad.
Have you been watching the same show as me?
Spoiler alert.
I thought he was a good person.
Spiller's bad. No. He's bad.
But he has blue eyes.
Oh. Still bad. Really bad. Crystal has blue eyes, too, but she's good. And it was, again, like the episode opened with the parallel scenes of the hospital. It ended with the parallel scenes of, like, confessions.
Yeah.
And promises. Broken
So
promises.
That is where we wrap up the season. And look at how much notes I have for 2 hours of notes.
I'm not ready for it to be over. I'm sad.
Yeah, I'm sad, too. Like, I actually really, especially, like, these final three episodes, I thought were really good. I think these final three episodes were probably the best episodes of the season.
And they were
It was
great.
Getting better.
It was. And what's sad is that if you look at, like, the ratings, it started to tick down.
Yeah.
So I really hope people see this. Maybe that's why they put the two episodes together at the end to really ramp up ratings so it can get renewed. It should be renewed because now the characters have found their relationship to one another. The writers seem to have a good meshing. You know, the directing, everything's spot on. I think we need a season two.
Well, the cool thing, the cool thing, too, and I like, and I was talking to Carrie about this before we started the show, is that they were really moving along. And it's almost like if you have a season two as well, we still have the idea. I mean, yeah, we still don't know who Sean Bean is for real, but at least they wrapped up some of these storylines, like that very first storyline of like, who are these agents? Who are these people coming to him? We have that wrapped up, and the story actually moved forward. And we got that, and then we got, I guess, this previous legend. We got one legend wrapped away, and there's another legend in there. But I mean, it's just like nice that at least they're starting to tick away those questions. And they actually are moving forward with them and not just leaving a lot of them hanging.
And moving forward, and in each storyline they present, it just folded into the overall arcing storyline. So well done. They hang their, you know, they don't hang the whole show on one concept of this guy just plays a bunch of legends. Like, there's so much more to it.
And another thing to think about too, if they do end up doing a season two, is how much different it's going to be.
Completely.
Because before we had just this whole structure of like, go to office, get your assignment, go do your assignment. And even though like there were a lot of like hinges and issues along the way, they always had the fact that they could rely on Nelson to say, don't worry, Sean Bean, everything that you do is just going to be wiped clean because you're in the FBI and it's all good.
Right.
Like now he's a fugitive and he can't just do things with a clean slate. Like things aren't going to just be cleanly wrapped up for him.
And he is, as the lead character, he's falling apart. He's starting to question himself too.
Yeah.
So maybe he completely turns his back on all this and goes to Fiji and says, I'm done. I'm just going to sit on the beach.
All right. So let's do predictions for season two if there's a season two.
Oh, I really hope.
And now your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
So I like your idea. The thought.
Say it again.
Well, the fact that you thought that, let me give you some credit. The idea of Crystal's father being involved because he is high up, and maybe that's going to help Crystal either get back on it or probably be more storyline with that, with how she gets back in the case.
Yeah, I think the VRX will still be there, but obviously it's not going to be as centered with the storyline. I think we're going to see more political, more government stuff. And it'd be perfect timing because the elections, the 2016 elections are coming up, so it'd be great for a show to kind of like start incorporating that because people are going to be talking about it. So if you're talking about it in your daily life and then you watch a show, now you're going to talk about the show when you're back at work. Like, it's very topical. So I just really think it's going to be more political, more government driven because people are already questioning the government. And if you're not questioning the government, you'll want to watch the show too because you'll want to, you know, do devil's advocate to all those who are conspiracy theorists. You know what I mean? I just think it's a show for everybody. I really wish it would be in the summertime though.
Yeah.
I think fall, I mean, I don't know. Clearly I'm not an exec, but I would love to see the show in the summer. I think it could pull some higher ratings.
Well, I think my prediction is if the show isn't renewed, it's because Sean Bean didn't die.
Oh, Dave, don't even put it out there. Okay, are you predicting that Sean Bean would be killed off in season two?
No,
if
I don't,
it even
I don't
comes
think
back?
He would. That would be really cool. I don't know. Like
come
I said,
back for one
even like
episode.
I don't know. It's like I said, though. Like, to me, that's a really cool twist. Like, if they had actually killed Sean Bean in the first episode of the show, I would have applauded the show for having the balls to advertise the way they did.
It's been a fantastic
and then
waste
killed
of
him
money.
Off in the first episode. That would have been, like, to me, the most brilliant advertising of all time. I would have stuck with the show 100%. Like, I can't believe they did that.
Take a big kahuna.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, no.
I mean, I don't think, if they have a season two, I don't think he's going to die. I think they're sticking with him. I mean, he's also just showing his great acting chops
it's
throughout the
fantastic.
Show.
Fantastic, and all the characters develop so much. Just think of that very first pilot episode and where they are now.
Yeah. But I don't know. I'm interested to see what happens. But I think you're right about Crystal and the dad relationship. And I'm just trying to think, like, how could he, as a fugitive, get back on track? Because what can he possibly do?
Well,
and I think maybe it'll be him going to Sonya and maybe them working together. That might be the only thing that he has. And obviously they have Nelson on their side. But I think maybe Sonya is going to be the key.
Oh, I like it.
Here, so.
So you're saying Sonya, I'm going to call political. I bet it all happens.
Yeah. So,
and I wonder if he works as a legend from another country. Like, will he stay out of the United States for season two, if there's a season two? Because that could add a nice element. Just think of all the crazy stuff going on in the world. So,
I don't know. But
I don't know.
What do you guys think watching at home or listening on iTunes? What do you think is going to happen? And what did you think of the final episodes? Did you
definitely
enjoy the finale?
Hear what you thought.
And are you hoping for a season two as well? Because I know I am now. Definitely.
100%.
So, guys, once again, I'm Dave Klein. You can find me on Twitter at TheDaveKlein. That is KLEIN.
Good. Very good. Hi, guys. You can find me on Twitter as well. I'd love to know your thoughts. You can find me at Comedia Carrie. That's ComediaCarrie. Hit me up.
And don't follow JB ever because he's an ass.
He's
not here.
He ditched us. He's at work.
Yeah, he's
so
at work.
So he claims.
He's at work. So
whatever.
Do follow JB. Make sure to check him out as well. And guys, thank you so much for joining us. We will maybe see you some other time.
Hopefully.
Later, guys. Bye.
Bye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.